Ukitaka mayai safi lazima kutafuta njia ya kuona na mayai mazuri pia ndani ya maji yale ambayo haina uzito mbaya yatatoka juu. Kitu mimi nauliza nyinyi leo, ili tuone hawa walio katika siasa, wale walio watumishi wa serikali, sisi tuseme kwamba tufungue, tuondoe ile section ya katiba ya Kenya ya 2A. Tufungue section hiyo, na nauliza nyinyi nyote kukaa na mimi, tuende barabara yetu tukiwa KANU pamoja.
I accept the choice of the people, and in particular now concede that Mr. Mwai Kibaki will be the third president of the Republic of Kenya.
Ewe Mwenyezi Mungu, nisaidie.
Do you believe that Mwai Kibaki fairly won the election?
I don't know.
Amekuwa amiri jeshi mkuu wa majeshi yote ya ulinzi ya Kenya.
Democracy is on trial.
Ni mwaka mmoja sasa tangu Uhuru Muigai Kenyatta kuingia ikulu ya Nairobi. Kuu tathmini ikifanywa, tumeamua kujaribu kujibu baadhi ya maswali ambayo bado yanawasumbua wa Kenya kuhusu uchaguzi mkuu uliopita.
Managing election in Kenya is a difficult job.
This friend of mine called me and said, Raila, I want to give me just 5 minutes of your time.
Raila was leading, and when I woke up the following morning, the gap had narrowed.
Mimi Mwai Kibaki naapa kwamba.
Those who say it's a darkness are exaggerators. It was late in the evening, yes, but it was not yet 6.
We essentially had 2007 again in 2013. We just didn't have the violence.
However, how much we don't really like the science of an election, because an election is science.
There would have been war and bloodshed. There's no doubt about it.
Disemba mwaka wa 2007.
We have the agent. We can produce the agent from NIDHI with information that was announced at the ground, which is not the same as the one that is being announced here.
If we are going to have a procedure of bringing agents, then we must bring for all. What I'm saying is that in the morning, when announcements were made, which were ODM strongholds, and the figures were quite high, that time it didn't seem to hurt people's ears. When PNU score is high, ears are hurting.
Mr. Chairman, please listen to me. Please listen, if you can hear me.
Cheche za maneno, mvutano na malumbano ya matokeo ya uchaguzi zilianza kugonga vichwa vya habari pale wana ODM walipohisi kuchezewa shere katika matokeo ya uchaguzi mkuu kutoka maeneo mbalimbali ikiwemo eneo la NIDHI.
This process must be transparent, must be free and fair. So what we are trying to do here is basically to help or assist the Electoral Commission to come out with a verdict that reflects the will of the people of Kenya. The people of Kenya have spoken, and they have spoken very loudly for change. And they don't want to be cheated at the desk here of what they have decided on.
We are not joking. This is not child's play. We made a statement here about an hour and a half ago about certain constituencies where results have been doctored.
Inchi nzima ilitetema huku kila Mkenya akitaka kutangazwa rasmi kwa matokeo ya uchaguzi. Kwa wakati huu wote mengi yalikuwa yakitendeka.
I think now you can tell those returning officers who delayed these results that the salaries of the 3-4 days you have been here will not be paid.
Huku malumbano na cheche za maneno zikiendelea kutanda katika jumba la KICC, Raila Amolo Odinga alipokea simu kutoka kwa mfanyabiashara mmoja mashuhuri ambaye pia ni mmiliki wa vyombo vya habari humu nchini na kutakiwa wakutane angalau kwa dakika 5 hivi katika hoteli moja ya kifahari hapa Nairobi.
We agreed to meet at the Nairobi Club. So we went to meet him at the Nairobi Club. When we met, I had arrived earlier. So when he arrived, he came and said, "Congratulations, Raila. But the good news, you have won the elections. You won the elections. Forget about the figures that they're announcing. I know that you have won. But I know where those figures are being cooked. Now the bad news is that Kibaki is going to be announced as the President of the Republic of Kenya this afternoon by the Electoral Commission, and he will be sworn in." Then he hesitated a bit. He went then on and said, "Look, you have two options. Either to dispute the elections, in which case there will be a lot of bloodshed, I can promise you. Or the alternative is to accept the elections and negotiate with Kibaki and become his vice president for 5 years. And then when the next elections come, he will back you. So you can make that as a condition. This is what I thought I could share with you. And leave these two options with you." That was the end of our conversation. Of course, I told him I could not make a decision at that moment in time. I would consult my colleagues. That was the end of our discussion.
Kimya kilitanda kwa muda huku baadhi ya viongozi wa ODM wakipinga mwaliko huo kuamua kumwapisha Raila Amolo Odinga katika bustani ya Uhuru kama rais wa 4 wa Jamhuri ya Kenya. Maandalizi kabambe ya kumuapisha Raila Odinga yaliandaliwa mara moja.
We came to the conclusion that without a doubt, the results of the elections had been rigged in favor of President Kibaki. And therefore, we suggested that if we could find a judge who was ready and willing to swear Raila Amolo Odinga as President of the Republic of Kenya, so be it, because you could hear the former chairman of the Electoral Commission, Mr. Kibwitu, also complaining about the way the results were coming, and he said they must be cooking the results somewhere. So we were absolutely convinced.
Who would have sworn you in? Did you have anybody in mind who was willing to do that?
We had a judge in mind, and I think we had made efforts to reach him, and I think there was positive information from his part, but I don't think it's right for me to disclose who the judge was.
The results are as follows. Honorable Raila Amolo Odinga, 4,215,437 votes. Honorable Mwai Kibaki, 3,748,261. Honorable Kalonzo Musyoka, 630,849. Honorable Raila Amolo Odinga is therefore the winner and the fourth president of the Republic of Kenya.
The swearing in was supposed to be done at the Uhuru Park. And I don't want to mention names now because it will then divide us between the extremists and the moderates, because we were all together as, and those who were against were actually considering the consequences of the kind of action that there will be a lot of bloodshed in the country, because what had become very apparent was that those guys were very determined to proceed with the rigged electoral results, that they would not cede power at any costs.
At least for William Ruto, who was part of your Pentagon, what side of the fence was he on?
Well, I don't know whether that's right. I think Bill was on the side of those who, wanted us to do the swearing in. But I must also add that even James Orengo was also that the same. Professor Nyang Nyong was also the same. There are a few others who wanted us to be sworn in. But then I realized that would cause even more commotion and violence in the country. I actually prevailed upon my colleagues that we should not go along that direction, but that we should preempt everything else by coming out openly with a statement to state that we knew exactly what had happened.
Wakidhani ni mchezo. Takriban mwendo wa saa 11 na dakika 38 za jioni, Emilio Mwai Kibaki alitangazwa rasmi kama rais wa Jamhuri ya Kenya.
The commission therefore declares Honorable Mwai Kibaki as the president of Kenya.
Now I'm going to start the process of swearing in. We are waiting for ambassadors, but because it's getting dark, we have to go ahead.
Mimi Mwai Kibaki na hapa kwamba nitatenda kazi zangu za uhariri urais
kazi zangu za uhariri, kazi zangu za uhariri urais.
Jina la uhalifu lilitumiwa dhidi yake na kuonekana kama aliyewaibia wa Kenya kura na demokrasia yao. Kibaki hakusita, bali aliendelea kwa kurudisha shukrani zake za dhati kwa vitengo viwili.
I thank the Electoral Commission of Kenya, our security agents.
Vitengo ambavyo vilidaiwa na kuonekana kumsaidia Kibaki katika uchaguzi wa mwaka wa 2007.
I would be beating Kibaki by 600,000 votes. So at that point in time, all the other returning officers from what they called their strongholds were, and who had not come to Nairobi, because they had been directed to stay behind until ODM strongholds had been counted and announced. They were all directed to the NSIS headquarters with the results. And that is where the doctoring took place. That's where they manufactured about 900,000 votes, so that we ended up from a 600,000 lead with a 300,000 deficit. In other words, now it ended up that Kibaki beat us by 300,000 votes. All those votes were actually manufactured.
Martha Wangari Karua, ambaye kwa wakati huo alikuwa waziri wa katiba ndani ya serikali ya Kibaki, anafutilia mbali tuhuma hizo na utata uliokuwa ukizingira uchaguzi na kuapishwa kwa rais Mwai Kibaki.
I think we like to forget memory things, because the last Mwai swearing in, he was also sworn in a hurry at Uhuru Park without many people. You know, people, we are guilty of selective amnesia whenever there is trouble. Because Moi was hurriedly sworn in the last time, it's like he thought an injunction would come from court. In Kibaki's case, he was sworn in around 5, it wasn't 6. Those who say it's a darkness are exaggerators. It was late in the evening, yes, but it was not yet 6. And yes, he had to be sworn in. I was the Justice Minister, and I want to tell you, without batting an eyelid, it was absolutely necessary he be sworn in at that evening, because that was the last day of his mandate. Failure to swear him in would have precipitated a constitutional crisis.
You were in government.
Yeah.
Do you think that the election was rigged?
I know from the Krigler report, and also from the outcome of the court petitions that were there pertaining to elections, that yes, the elections were exaggerated, the votes were exaggerated in some areas, in PNU strongholds, and in some areas in ODM strongholds. Those who analyze those elections say that even with exaggeration, that Kibaki's votes were still ahead of Raila's. But now, when there is exaggeration on both sides, it leads one to conclude the way Justice Krigler concluded, that it is pointless. You cannot even say who won, who didn't. So from me, in the beginning, I genuinely believed that the results given by the Electoral Commission were the results. But the later events showed that we may never get to know the truth about 207 because of the exaggeration on both sides.
Vyombo vya madola vikiongozwa na gazeti la The Economist, na nikinukuu, lilitaja matokeo hayo kama wizi na mapinduzi halisi ya Kiafrika, nalo gazeti la Daily Telegraph likisema kuwa Kibaki aliiba kura. Muda mfupi baadaye, ghasia zilitanda kote nchini. Wakenya wasio na hatia zaidi ya 1,000 waliuawa kinyama. Hey, Damu za watoto wasio na hatia zilimwagika, wengine wakibakwa na kuteketea kwa moto kama inavyochomwa mishikaki, wengine wengi kuachwa na majeraha na vilema vya maisha katika vipindi vilivyosalia vya maisha yao. Huu haukuonekana kama wizi wa kura, bali ubakaji wa demokrasia na ubakaji wa maisha na haki ya msingi ya kuishi ya Wakenya. Kuongeza kidonda msumari wa moto, Kalonzo Musyoka alitangazwa kama makamu wa rais. Wakenya walimuona kama msaliti aliyechagua kazi juu ya maisha ya Wakenya. Kinyume na madai hayo, mara ya kwanza Stephen Kalonzo Musyoka alipasua mbarika na kuweka mambo wazi.
It was clear the country was first of all bleeding. I did not ask Kalonzo Musyoka. It was a decision of the supreme organ of my party. I remember before I went to sleep, all right, I saw there was like a big gap. Raila was leading, and when I woke up the following morning, the gap had narrowed. And so when that happened, there was a lot of tension. And so my own party members started calling, and we had to come then to Nairobi. We were consulting, consultations. I can't precisely remember, I never myself spoke to Kibaki directly. Yeah, but there are those political advisors and others who were in touch with my party members. So my party got to meet, and we agreed to a meeting. So that's how it started. And the whole thing was to stop the bloodletting.
I was not privy to it. I cannot talk about it. I suddenly saw Kalonzo and the Wiper Party after the elections when they came as coalition partners. And I was personally grateful because they gave us the gravitas that we needed. But I was later to learn that there was a relationship, which I was not privy to.
Kalonzo Musyoka hatimaye anasema aligundua mambo ya ajabu yaliyokuwa yakiendelea ndani ya serikali. Serikali ambayo anasema ilikuwa mbili ndani ya moja.
There was a government within a government. There were the operatives, so those who had already been assured that they were the government, and that somebody like Raila Odinga was prime minister, was vice president, but we're not insiders. We did not control the national security intelligence.
So in all this power game, those who control real estate power knows where you must have your hand on. And a lot of people think that President Kibaki was a hands-off man, but when it came to dockets that were very important, finance, central bank, and security, he wanted briefings, and not just briefings, regular briefings.
Hatimaye ODM na PNU waliunda serikali ya muungano. Serikali ya kwanza barani Afrika na iliyofuatiliwa kwa kuundwa kwa katiba mpya.
I, Mwai Kibaki.
I, Raila Amolo Odinga.
Huu ulionekana kama mwanzo wa mwamko mpya, mwanzo wa taifa litakaloheshimu uamuzi wa wananchi. Kila mmoja alificha kucha zake na kungoja uchaguzi mkuu wa mwaka wa 2012. Niko hapa katika daraja la Nelson Mandela, Johannesburg, Afrika Kusini, katika ziara ya kumtafuta jamaa mmoja. Naye siyo mwingine ila ni Jaji Johan Kriegler, aliyeleta mapendekezo mbalimbali katika zoezi la upigaji kura nchini Kenya. Kivuli chake cha mwaka wa 2008 bado kinaashiria maono na ndoto bora zaidi kwa taifa la Kenya. Akiwa na rekodi ya mwenyekiti wa kwanza wa tume ya uchaguzi nchini Afrika Kusini, aliyemtangaza Nelson Mandela kama mshindi wa urais mwaka wa 1994. Johan Kriegler amekuwa kipenzi cha wengi, kando na kujipatia rekodi safi ya kutambulika kote duniani.
I can't resist preaching. I am an old man and I've seen a great deal and I have learnt a good deal. Ultimately, you cannot run an honest election in a dishonest environment.
Hata baada ya kujua yaliyokuwa yakijiri mwaka 2007, Kriegler alijizatiti kuregesha Kenya katika ramani, huku akitayarisha taifa lililokuwa limegawanywa katika misingi ya kikabila kwa uchaguzi huru utakaofuatia, kando na kuikosoa tume ya ECK.
They were so bad in their data collection and in their data transmission and in their data collation that one could not find out what had actually happened.
Kilichofuatia ni ECK kubanduliwa, huku ile ya IBC ikichukua nafasi yake na kujitayarisha kuongoza upigaji kura ya kwanza kielektroniki, lengo la kuzuia wizi wa kura.
We said that you should ensure that the transmission of the data, both parliamentary but and presidential, but particularly presidential, you should see to it that what you establish at the polling station level is accurately and speedily transmitted electronically to constituency level and from the constituency through to the national level, so that you do not have this time lag and these errors in transmission that the ECK perpetrated.
Serikali ilikubali kukata utepe mwekundu unaozuia upatikanaji wa kivunge cha usajili wa wapiga kura kibiometriki, almaruf BVR, kwa tume huru ya uchaguzi na mipaka IEBC. Mfumo huu mpya ulionekana kubadili usajili wa wapiga kura kwa mkono, kuhakikisha uchaguzi wa amani, huru na wa haki. Wakenya waliamini kuwa huu ndio utakaokuwa mwanzo wa demokrasia halisi ya upigaji kura, kama ilivyopendekezwa na Jaji Johan Kriegler, kuepuka kurudia vurugu zilizosababisha mauaji ya makumi ya watu mwaka wa 2007. Jina la BVR kwa mara ya kwanza lilianza kusikika vinywani mwa Wakenya. Mashine ya uandikishaji wa kielektroniki itakayochukua data za sehemu muhimu za mwili kuhusu raia kama vile sura, jiometria ya kiganja, mboni na alama za vidole. Kimsingi, katika zoezi hili, tarakilishi iliyokuwa imeunganishwa na kamera, mashine ya kuchapisha pamoja na ile ya kuchukua jiometria ya kiganja ilibuniwa. Kazi yake ilikuwa kunakili jina la mpiga kura, siku ya kuzaliwa, mahala pa kuzaliwa, jinsia, anwani, nambari ya kitambulisho, nambari ya pasipoti, picha ya mpiga kura, chapa ya jiometria ya kiganja, eneo bunge, wadi na eneo la kupigia kura. Hii ingeliwezesha kuzuia wizi wa kura, kwani kila ripoti ya mpiga kura ilikuwa tayari imenaswa kwa picha, kiganja na kitambulisho na kuwekwa chini ya udhibiti wa hifadhi ya tume huru ya uchaguzi nchini Kenya, IEBC. Lakini kabla ya mashine hizo kuingizwa nchini, mvutano ulijiri baina ya serikali ya muungano.
The procurement was botched up, and that there were interests outside of the Electoral Commission, and I tend to think that the two major coalition partners had opposing interests in the procurement. That is my guess.
And from the information available, there was disagreement among the commissioners who were meddling in procurement, insisting that they needed to vet the abilities of the companies which had tendered.
Everything went wrong, from the procurement, as we now know, to I remember that little debate at that particular time, whether or not to have the biometric voter registration itself. The two political divides, because there are two, the PNU side, the coalition, and I was, of course, at that particular time part of them, and the ODM, people trying to understand what would be in their best interests. Yeah, I think that was one of the problems.
Taifa la Ufaransa ndilo lililoonekana kama chaguo bora na serikali iliyokubalika kusaidia Kenya na mashine hizo za kupigia kura.
There was a government of France, government of Canada, I think approaches was all made to the United Kingdom. But down the line, you know, the whole program was shifted.
Was there any beneficiary out of it? Did COD benefit from it? And did the PNU side benefit from it?
I think if COD benefited, it would have been very easy for that to come out. And I think at that time, you know, to have any kind of fraudulent transaction between elements within COD or and PNU was extremely difficult, because at that time, actually, we are not seeing eye to eye in many ways.
Reach a stage where elections were coming and the registration of voters had not started because this equipment had not been procured. So when the alarms were raised, there's a red light, that's when the government came in. The president convened a meeting. So we ended up getting a loan from Standard Chartered to buy this equipment at a 7% interest.
Majina ya mataifa mengine yalianza kutajwa katika zabuni hiyo, ikiwemo Canada na Afrika Kusini. Muda ulikuwa ukiyoyoma, na wanasiasa pia walianza kuonekana kutokuwa na imani na IEBC.
When we went for the last meeting as presidential candidates with the Electoral Commission at the Grand Regency, you could almost hear the Electoral Commission saying the systems will fail. They were preparing us for a failure of the systems.
At what point did you feel that there was something wrong with the tendering issue?
You know, when it became public that there was jostling, you know, the cancellation, the restarting, a lot of movement about the BVR kit. Even as we went to the elections, the company that has ended up going to court on it was lobbying individual members about taking up the issue in Parliament. I was actually lobbied towards the end of December, beginning of January, and I felt it was too late to, you know, make any such claim, because if information had been brought out before, then you can deal with it.
These issues which were raised were not satisfactorily answered. Then we were called for a meeting at the IBC. So I went with my running mate for this meeting. But again, nothing substantive was discussed.
Both Raila and Uhuru and Mother Karua said no, we must have these machines in the polling station. Even after we told them, time is very short, they have been deployed very late, please allow us to use the printed. You know, in every polling station, there was also, not manual, not called manual. It is a printed copy of the data in the iPad, or I mean in the laptop. Yes. It contains your photograph, Alan, and everything else. That's what we use for the referendum and all other by-elections. This is the first time we're using these machines. So we told them, allow us to use this printed copy of the register to enable us, because this thing, we may not be able to do it in good time. And they said, no way. You must do it. All of them refused. Okay, some few of them were not averse to us going, DIDA, I think the smaller parties, eh? But the big boys, Raila and his running mate, Uhuru and his running mate, and especially Martha Karua, were very, very particular about these machines being there.
Wasilokuwa wakijua wa Kenya ni kwamba wiki kadhaa kabla ya uchaguzi mkuu, vyama vya kisiasa na wanahabari walikuwa wakiulizia kufanywa kwa jaribio za mashine hizo, kuonyesha iwapo zitafanya kazi hiyo bila itilafu yoyote. lakini IEBC ilishikilia msimamo wake wa kuwa wako tayari kwa uchaguzi huru. Barua pepe hii tulionayo na iliyoandikiwa makamishna wa IEBC inaonyesha wazi kuwa kampuni ya Face Technologies ilikuwa imetoa msimamo wake kamili kabla ya kutiwa sahihi kwa kandarasi hiyo Desemba mosi, lakini kwa sababu ya 66 ya IEBC mambo yalikwenda kombo. Ronan McDermott wa kampuni ya IFES, International Federation for Electro Systems, alimwandikia barua pepe naibu kamishna wa IEBC Wilson Sholei na kumjuza kuhusiana na vipengele muhimu. Barua hiyo inasema hivi:
kutokana na kuchelewa kwa zabuni yenu hadi wa sasa, imewalazimu washiriki kubadilisha matumizi yake maalum kwa sababu hawawezi kuagiza baadhi ya vitu husika. Msimamo wa washiriki ni dhahiri kabisa na kueleweka mwishoni mwa Novemba. Iwapo mnataka vifaa hivyo kuwasilishwa, ni lazima mtii sahihi ya makubaliano kufikia Desemba tarehe 2. Kwa sasa muda huu umepita, kwa hivyo iwapo mnataka vifaa lazima msalimishe modem ya 3G.
Barua hiyo iliendelea kusema,
tofauti na BVR ambapo makataa ya siku 30 ilitolewa kuipa IEBC muda wa kutatua masuala ya mashine ya EVID, mtapewa fursa moja tu na ni sharti muwe waangalifu katika maeneo 1030 kwa pamoja. Hamna la kuongeza wala kupunguza, ni mashine mpya ya kipekee itakayotumiwa kote nchini. Kwa ufupi, ulinganifu wa zabuni ndio mojawapo ya kizingiti kinachowakabili IEBC.
Barua pepe hii ilitumiwa pia afisa mkuu wa IEBC James Oswago na kamishina wa masuala ya mawasiliano ya IT Dismas Ongondi. Ilani nyingine iliyotolewa na Face Technology ni ile barua ya mkopo ya kuhakikisha IEBC ilikuwa na fedha ya kulipia mashine za EVID. Face Technologies ilikuwa imetazamia kuwasilisha mashine ya EVID mjini Nairobi kufikia tarehe 31 Januari mwaka wa 2013. Bila ya barua ya mkopo, mashine hizo hazingeliwasilishwa. Barua hiyo iliandikiwa afisa mkuu wa IEBC James Oswago na bwana A Apple Green, mkurugenzi wa masuala ya fedha wa Face Technologies, na iliyoandikwa tarehe 16 Januari mwaka jana, siku 46 kabla ya uchaguzi mkuu. Barua hiyo ambayo ni ya muhimu haikuwa imewasilishwa kufikia mwisho wa siku hiyo. Mwaka wa 2012 IEBC ilikuwa imejuzwa na kuonywa iwapo utaratibu huo hautafuatwa. Februari tarehe 26, siku 6 kabla ya upigaji kura, mashine hizo ziliwasili. Ishara ya kwanza ya matatizo. Ndivyo mambo yalivyo. Navuta unyunyu kwa muda na nitakaporejea nitakupa uhondo kamili. Usibonyeze kidude. Ghana ni taifa la kwanza la watu weusi barani Afrika lililoweza kupata uhuru wake. Taifa ambalo lilisifiwa na rais wa Marekani Barack Hussein Obama kutokana na mfano mzuri wa demokrasia barani Afrika. Ni taifa ambalo lilitumia mashine ya BVR katika usajili wa wapiga kura sawia na taifa la Kenya. Lakini je, ni tofauti zipi zilijiri katika zoezi la upigaji kura nchini Ghana na ile ya Kenya? Daktari Kwado Afarigian, mwenyekiti wa tume ya uchaguzi nchini Ghana, aliyelimbikiziwa sifa kedekede katika chaguzi tano nchini humo tangu mwaka 1992, anaelezea siri ya upigaji kura nchini Ghana tofauti na Kenya iliyotumia takriban mwezi kama mmoja hivi kujiandaa.
Well, it took us all together no less than 6 months. No less than 6 months. The actual, the preparatory period aside. the actual registration, the cleaning, took no less than 6 months. And it's a miracle if you are able to do it in less than 6 months and do it well. The ideal thing is to, if you want to introduce any new technology, is to have enough time to test it, right, and make sure that it will work before you go into it. The time that you had in Kenya was not sufficient, you know, to do all the things that needed to be done. The procurement process, this is competitive international bidding, international competitive bidding. So we advertise not only locally, also advertise internationally. And in the end, we had about 47 companies expressing interest.
Tofauti na mfano bora wa Ghana, nchini Kenya, moto wa BVR ulipowacha kutokota, masuala ya BVR ilitupwa katika kaburi la sahau, huku wa Kenya wakijiandaa kupiga kura. Huku hayo ya kijiri, wagombeaji wa Jubilee walijipata katika njia panda, njia ya kutoa uongozi raundi ya kwanza, na jinamizi la mahakama ya jinai ya ICC, iliyokuwa ikiwakabidhi Uhuru Muigai Kenyatta na William Samoei Ruto.
Well, at that time, I think PNU, elements within PNU were concerned about the effect of the results of the elections. There were many pending issues. First of all, there was the assumption that, if probably COD won the elections, and then the matters before the ICC were going to be even more complicated. And in PNU's estimation, control of the state, and that means through what would appear as a process of an election, was critical. And we have seen eventually what has happened, that the fact that those who are before the ICC are in control of the state machinery, they have been able to have an impact on the proceedings. I am sure that if they were not in control of the government, that impact would, I'm not sure that impact would be there.
We've heard about these elements before. Who are they specifically? Because people from COD keep on mentioning that there are elements within the government that were fighting democratization, the elections being held fairly. Who are these people?
No, me, I've always argued that the old order was always there, right from the time of, for those who are alive and in control of the Kenyatta regime, to the Moi and Kibaki. They had a consistent and live chain from that time. And they control state machinery, and they know what it means to control state machinery. And I think they put their efforts into the security agents, and more importantly, the intelligence.
Because of the ICC issue, the Jubilee campaign had a very, very powerful mobilizing tool in both senses, two senses. First of all, because their two candidates were indictees, they had every reason to try as hard as they could to win that election. And also from their supporters, who viewed this from the beginning as something that was politically targeted, politically motivated, a tool of outsiders, a mechanism trying to favor their main opponent, and so on and so forth. So as I was moving around Central Province on election day, and I was asking people, why are you voting for Jubilee? I would say overwhelmingly that was the reason I was given, to protect our heroes.
Katika vipindi vilivyosalia, TNA ilikuwa tayari imejiandaa kutoa ushindi, maandalizi kabambe yakijadiliwa. Jubilee ilionekana bora zaidi katika maandalizi yake tofauti na koda. Wasomi kadhaa barobaro walihusishwa katika kampeni ya Uhuru Muigai Kenyatta kama mojawapo ya kupata umaarufu na kunyakua kura za vijana.
I was tasked with coming up with what you'd call
the secret arm of the campaign. A good battalion that's going to either a peace mission or a war mission must have the front end and the back end. So I was the back end. I was the team that I headed was in charge of fueling all the other visible teams. In actual sense, if you go back to the campaign time, you will not see me anywhere because my role was clear and I executed it as such. First, when Johnson Sakaja gave me a call and asked me if I would be interested in joining the Uhuru Kenyatta campaign, I told him I would be interested to join, but on condition that I understood why he was why. And so I told him the only person who can answer that question is the candidate himself. And so when I met the candidate, about 3 weeks after that conversation, I put the question to him, why do you want to be president? He then took me on a drive while he was driving into South B, into a place which I will not mention here. But in there, he showed me people who he used to interact with. In terms of when he was in the opposition, when even before he joined politics, the places where he used to go to. Then after that, he took me to a home just shortly after Nairobi, where there was a mother who was taking care of about 8 children. And I came to learn that he had asked her to get the orphans in that region and house them, and then he would finance them. And he did not want the matter to go public at that time. So he just wanted to help the kids. And as we drove back, it's around 10 at night, he told me that is why I want to be president. He wanted to change the way life is. He told me, even if you had all the money in the world, if you have a bottle of soda, how many of them? You can't take a whole crate of them. So his philosophy was very clear, and he did not interpret it for me. He left it to me to interpret. Up to today, I've never really understood what he really meant, but he gave me we set up the place, and then when you are ready to start, he gave me two items. He gave me a book by Lee Kuan Yew, From Third World to First, and then he gave me a movie, Shaka Zulu. I must admit here, I put that Shaka Zulu movie on my DVD player, and it played halfway. First time I was wondering, why am I watching this movie? I can't follow the movie. So I just got it out, until much later in 2012 when he asked me whether I'd watch the movie, and he started referring. So I had to watch the movie to understand what exactly it was. But those two things are actually what was the plan.
It was really an issue of knowing your opponent. But not only knowing your opponent, but also having a very keen eye on the ultimate prize. Because, for example, we had many obstacles and court ahead. If we had a petition challenging the eligibility of our candidates, for us really it was to ensure that we are presidential candidates. And like them, they knew they were presidential candidates. For us, it was purely speculative. Presidential elections are no child play. It requires huge investment in regard to times, it requires huge investment in regard to training. And that is why we're able to tap into the best brains in our market, as it is. Yeah? People that had a previous experience in electoral management who are then guiding our electoral process. Yeah? Our process was led by the dynamic duo of Winnie Gushu and Davis Chirchir, yeah, the technical experts.
CORD ilijipa imani kama chama cha Wakenya na kuweka imani yao yote kwa wapiga kura bila kuzingatia mikakati maalum ikilinganishwa na mwaka wa 2007. Ndani ya CORD unadaiwa kuwa na wasaliti, kuma ajenti wao wakidaiwa kujiepusha kuwakilisha vyama vyao katika ngome za TNA, aidha kwa kuhofia usalama wao au kwa kuhadaiwa na pesa.
Some places party agents disappeared for whatever reasons. Some weren't deployed in certain areas in the first place, again for various reasons. Even this question of, I wouldn't say it was a mistake by CORD or by ODM as such, but there were
some suggestions that partly because of our polls, and when I say our, I don't mean just Ipsos, but all the four companies, none of which predicted a first round win. It was widely assumed, I think by you people in the media also, maybe because of us, that there was going to be a runoff. So there have been some allegations, I can't prove them, some allegations that at least on the court side, some resources that might have been spent or utilized on the first round were withheld, seeing as they would be very useful, if not necessary, in the course of a second round runoff.
We had our agents in most polling stations. There are areas where our agents were physically blocked from entering polling stations, or some of them were bribed. In most areas, they were just physically blocked.
TNA, iliwalenga na kuwasajili vijana kwa wingi.
The driving force of the registration exercise, in my perspective, was excitement perhaps people had in this election. If you're able to create hype, you know, if you're able to make this election a must election for everyone to participate, then you got people getting out to register. And then it also narrows down to the mobilization skills of every political outfit we have in the country.
The Jubilee campaign was clearly, as you just pointed out, on an upward trajectory. And we had no way of predicting what the turnout would be. And we could see in some areas like Coast, it was far lower than in strongholds. And that applies to the strongholds of both presidential candidates. But the turnout, if you go and look at the turnout in the two deputy presidential candidates, and now the deputy president's stronghold, home area, I mean, Kalenjin areas versus Kamba areas, for example, you can see that the turnout was considerably higher in Kalenjin areas than in Ukambani.
Siku ya kupiga kura ilipofika, shughuli ilianza bila tashwishi yoyote. Lakini baada ya kupiga hatua kadhaa, mashine zilianza kugoma.
Many things led to the failure of the events. One of them was, of course, the late procurement. And so when they were delivered very late, some of them were being delivered as late as 26th of February, when election is 4th of March. So imagine, even training the staff was very hard because they were being trained in theory. They didn't have been, they even have the machine to test and be able to understand. And yes, some of them may not have had the SD cards fully loaded with the data. So when they went to the police station, you put the SD card, you put on the laptop, you find it's empty. That may have also happened in some police stations. Also in most police stations, they forgot to charge the laptops or the devices before they took it to the police station. It requires to be charged 8 hours fully before you go and deploy it. And once the battery goes down, you change the batteries.
A machine is only as good as the people who operate it. You cannot ensure the integrity of the voter's roll with the most fancy electronic mechanisms that you can imagine. Ultimately, it will depend upon the competence and integrity of the people who operate those machines.
There was no data being verified. In other words, the gadgets, the equipment that they brought at polling stations were incapable of reading the information which was available in the data bank, the biometric data which was there in the data bank, and that Kenyans were just being conned. When you put your finger there, it was just like touching a mouse or a computer.
Hali ya waka ilianza kutanda huku kukidaiwa kuwa na mgawanyiko ndani ya makamishna wa IEBC. Wengine wakihisi udanganyifu, huku wengine wakiona kila kitu kuwa shwari. Katika makao makuu ya sayansi na usalama hapa Pretoria, Afrika Kusini, afisi ambazo zinashughulikia masuala ya rekodi za alama za vidole, na sura, swala la mashine kugoma katika zoezi la aina yote ile, inachukuliwa vingine.
Why should you have the two? There is no specific reason why you would want to have the two. Maybe the 442 scanner is expensive to buy in large scale. So maybe it would be cheaper to deploy cheaper scanners to all the other registration places, other places where you need to identify people. Because remember, since all you need is a fingerprint image, whichever scanner can capture a fingerprint image can give you the signal you need to do the comparison. Because minutia in one fingerprint image and another fingerprint image from different scanners will be the same.
The data is held in one server here. And so a poll book in Marsabit or Kisumu or Garissa will not be able to log in to a data in Nairobi and be able connectivity. We don't have a network connectivity between here and all the regions.
A lot of these machines are specified to operate within a lot of the environments I could envision. And I imagine since it's, say, for example, looking at voter registration, it would be done under a controlled environment, in a room with a shade and everything, so I don't see why the system wouldn't be able to operate and it would be affected by environmental conditions.
Biometrics is the process of using a format which you can't separate. It's a metric, a measurable feature unique to you, either directly unique or in unison with other forms of information unique.
Mingairi na dosari za mashine kufeli wakati wa shughuli ya upigaji kura. Kila kosa lililokuwa likijiri lilifaulu kupenyeza bila ya kujulikana na Wakenya. Ni mtu mmoja tu alikuwa na ufahamu wa yaliyokuwa yakijiri katika kinyang'anyiro hicho cha karibu baina ya Raila Odinga na Uhuru Kenyatta. James Oswago, afisa mkuu wa IEBC. Oswago anadaiwa kugadhabishwa na mambo yaliyokuwa yakitendeka katika mawasiliano haya ya kipekee ya simu tuliofaulu kupata. Oswago anasikika akitoa lalama na kukiri mengi zaidi kwa jamaa fulani ambaye ni mshiriki wa karibu wa Raila Odinga. Kwa mujibu wa mawasiliano hayo, Oswago anamwaga mtama zaidi na kusema kuwa watu fulani wasiokuwa wafanyikazi wa IEBC walihusishwa katika shughuli hiyo.
So imbe Kenya na Gikwale.
Yes.
Gidonje before because of ku chake ni.
It is highly probable.
Ngarginu
ni ngi jawen. Jauganya mama korwa.
Itu yang jadi berkuat ni kan, mengano ni? Mengano lagi ingo? Mengano ingo mor ada ngan loka loka ni ingo kubik kapuk kubik karo 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 kan?
Oh, ngano ni karu kanyo?
Ya.
Oh, koro karu kanyo bilungnya. Tu kujana ngat mono no.
Eh, kujana ngat mono no.
Senior?
Kenya Revenue Authority.
Oh, Kenya Revenue Authority. Lakini yana na karukanyo. Oh, no wacho ni ka unepuko biro karu na eno tiyo ki Kenya Revenue Authority.
Yes.
Odonyo karuka karano?
About 4 or 5 months ago.
I listened to that. First, I can't recognize my voice. Secondly, the other correspondent of mine is totally distorted. So even if I were able to reconstruct and ask if it was me or not, I can't. That is not me. That's not my voice. But the issues, every single issue that is raised there, I can respond to and very truthfully. In that recording, the person who is said to be me is saying the other individual is asking him to name the person. The person who is supposed to be Oswago has not named the person. He is telling the other person that whoever you are talking to, you can get the name from another party. But if you recall, in the conversation, the person who is purported to be me is saying very clearly that our selection process for recruitment is so rigorous that it is doubtful an individual like that could have been accepted into the system. That is there in the recording, isn't it? That I was not suspicious that it was infiltrated. But I will tell you, frankly speaking, that as the CEO, and the thing has failed, and failed badly as such, you ask yourself critical questions. And you ask yourself logical questions. And there are about 7 questions which we asked ourselves. One of them was that.
There was absolutely no infiltration. I don't understand you say infiltration by who? But we are fully in control of our systems, and to my knowledge, I have no evidence of any infiltration. It's indeed true that the machines failed to transmit as we expected. Systems were on, and we expected it to work as promised by our IT guys, but it failed for reasons which are in public domain. We don't know why it failed, but mostly because of trainings and I think the machines fail for reasons well within the public knowledge.
Eight, mano jogo origi ya come out of the elections forcefully.
It won't be the first time.
Yeah, it's not the first time being rigged, but you know, it's not nice at all. It's not good for the country. It's not good for the it's not good for Kenya at all. Why an innocent man should be rigged out of elections twice, and this time around with reloaded impunity?
Kenya said that we get there.
That's
a concluding in the yard, eh? And you go. Then I'm looking at that. The concluding in the yard. I'm not even aware of my yellow. No? Thirdly?
Yes.
Kan wagelo register wa, wano wagelo register ni belum mewa. Beri kita diterima dan penghantar sesi. Ini kita keluar reviews, mau bedo about 32,000 something. Kau tiap malam, malam kita kuno konsal, kau kuno ni juga pay.
Oh, multi minder malih.
Jamaa wa ujasusi anayezungumziwa hapa ni mtu tunayemjua na kumfahamu na aliye na wadhifa wa juu. Hata hivyo, KTN haiwezi kubaini iwapo ndiye aliyehusika. Hivyo basi, hatuwezi taja jina lake.
okinyago register to koro ngi son register manyu wolo ni oke mano oke mane omiji
mano mano tiyo go oke mano miyo oke mano wati nizo e mo mino ango se kwende mo oko nemu ni mo unugo opore gi nemu ni mawano go
ngi son that one should be wrong e man koro is not known on public domain
public domain ako nge but you see
mm.
now that kan yogi with the benefit of hindsight anong ni mano na tukiba bwana ma jalwencha mapo kuemboja ya kuemboja kwa mboaji
ii jafuwa mboaji nga mani
ee nike nikiko rene anoka yote jogi mutan a discover ni yom yogi nitimbre en nike uni rejisa mungeo oke mawango anna mwe nimbi ni mwone nogi kuendo gi gibiro no mopogre to kina okonya justify ni kibwe churu no wachu no
Mingairi na hayo mazungumzo yao yalijadili masuala ya kesi hiyo kupelekwa katika mahakama kuu kando na madai mengine mapya ya watu zaidi kuhusika na ambao hatuwezi thibitisha kama KTN
Number one.
Yes
Samudindo udenu de samudi kurunu dwado Udodokye, ndumyo undodu yeru.
Hmm.
Ukwa the same judicial.
Aha.
Mwando wache, ni telo maru pinyo wacho. Kik. And at, ya telo maru pinyo wacho, maso wando so.
Aha.
At pain of personal sanction. O ensure, ni umibura moro molosi at the top level, badi ngi yeru noma unuwegi kada uwege ya, o ni representative. At all levels of the government up to the lowest.
Mm.
Number one. Number two.
Mano you mean ja kachera cha ja fuambocha?
No, mano the chief secretary.
Huh?
Chief secretary.
Sorry, kawinji.
Jagoro maduong.
Oh, mano ma nga mani ya rambe avenja. Oh. Eh, sawa.
Not no di joget not to know anyone in Jogin.
Huku shughuli ya kuhesabu kura ikiendelea, mashine ya kuchukua data za wapiga kura almaruf server kwa lugha ya kimombo ya IEBC iligoma kufanya kazi na kuzimika. Wasilokuwa wakijua wa Kenya ni kwamba kulikuwa na wageni waliokuwa wakifuatilia uchaguzi huo kwa karibu. Magwiji wa kudukuza tarakilishi almaruf computer hackers waliokuwa wakifanya hivyo kwa maslahi ya vyama vyao. Licha ya Jubilee kutumia kampuni ya Kencol kupokea matokeo yao katika uchaguzi huo kupitia njia ya simu, IEBC na Jubilee kwa mujibu wa kesi iliyowasilishwa na CORD mahakamani ni kwamba zilitumia server moja kupitia nyaya ya fiber optic zilizokuwa zimezikwa ardhini toa chapa za matokeo kwa makamishna wa IEBC. Mtandao ambao unadaiwa kuchangia pakubwa katika ubadilishaji wa matokeo kutoka maeneo ya upigaji kura na kuonyesha matokeo yasiyo kamili kwa ushawishi wa tarakilishi nyingine na iliyo na uwezo juu ya ile ya IEBC.
Now this call center was based in Bomas of Kenya. We gave them a room. They were there under guard, and they were printing out the report for the commission's secretariat every 1 hour. Now we understand now from the Supreme Court case that TNA also used the same company to give them a call center. So maybe they also employed 20 staff or 30 staff. Had their own office somewhere else, and they also receive calls from the agents. Now, sharing a company which is giving you a service. If you are supplying water, Alan, and I ask you to supply me water, and the producer gives you the same order, it doesn't mean that we are sharing the we are sharing a server with you. We are only sharing your service
you're a service provider. You're giving a call center service. So we shared, yes, the same company gave us the call center services. But never did we share a server.
We realized that there was some finger which was influencing the results. And we managed to get some people who were involved in manipulation of these results at the Ken Call Center. And we tried to bring this to the attention of the IEBC. And we also actually did a press conference. My running mate addressed a press conference and said that there was a manipulation of the result which was going on. Because at that time the media was being suppressed. So even the content of that press conference was never publicized.
The outsourcing of Kencall was within the offices because we were using their staff. The aspect of outsourcing, remember, was because we didn't have capacity staff-wise. So we were relying on their expertise on taking calls, customer service, and then adding our political aspect in terms of a political person to manage those guys who were given by Kencall. No, there was no Kencall at Bomas. We went to their Kencall. The issue of Kencall was from their offices.
And it's not TNA Kencall.
That I will leave to the necessary people who are at Bomas, because I did not go to Bomas. But my understanding of outsourcing to Kencall was in their offices. They gave us their staff. It was actually in their offices, because, I mean, even calling them, we used to go to their offices and check the results. Both at the party nomination level and the presidential nomination.
Do you have the allegations of sharing the sample?
Now that is the most ridiculous allegation, and that is where analog comes in. That is like arguing if Raila Odinga has a Gmail account and President Uhuru Kenyatta has a Gmail account, they read each other's mails. It is absolutely ridiculous. There in a server there are very many processes, and within that processes there is a dispatcher. So you receive all the information, but a dispatcher which is inbuilt within the servers dispatches to the relevant places. So that if Yahoo has a 60,000 megabyte server, when it gets in, it is able to dispatch. It is able to dispatch the different places where it's going. It's to John Alan Namo, it's to Muhammad Ali. It dispatches accordingly to the program that you have done it. Even if you are to share a server, which I don't even know whether it's true, but even if the Kencall server was one, it is impossible to cross-read data in that server.
There was a server which was serving both the TNA and the IBC. And since, you know, there was no wall between these two systems, they were like married. And therefore, even at that center where, you know, both the institutions were being served by the same server, it was possible even at that center to interfere with the results. So that, you know, they were in fact able to determine how they were faring before the group which was at IBC would, while we were waiting for those results.
Why would a call center need a fiber optic connection to Bomas?
Now those are the technical issues that we'll have to ask the IT director, but I don't know why. The result transmission was different from the call center. The call center was purely telephone calls from the field
to address
problems that they were facing in the field, yes.
So
not that, no.
But since then, we discovered that there were two other servers. There was one at NSIS, and then there was another one at Kencall, that's the area. Kencall Center, it's a call center, was linked through a fiber optic cable to the Bomas of Kenya. That information was never disclosed to anybody by the IABC. But what was even interesting is that at the Kencall Center there, you had both IABC and TNA were co-hosted. They were sharing one IT number at that place. So this information was never made public to anybody, because at the meeting which IBC had with us, one would have expected that this disclosure would be made for us, so that the issues of conflict of interest could be raised at that point in time.
It's not true that our server was kept by NSIS. That is the most ridiculous allegation I've had. I think, and certainly, President Kibaki never interfered with the elections. He was very, very supportive of the commission.
Why that should be done in a place, done in a shared location with one of the political parties contesting the election, that's the issue, is that there's no reason why you would do that, especially given the context of this election and the context of Kenyan elections in general. You would want, as an election commission, you want to do everything in any country to, you know, give confidence to the people that you are impartial and objective. And if you're sharing something, a space, even if it's just a room where you're collecting results, if you're sharing that space with one of the contenders in the election, it makes it very difficult to view you as an objective body.
When the electoral body has no respect for the law, is full of impunity, can you expect them to observe either the law or fairness during elections?
Kuzimwa au kuharibika kwa mtandao huo wa server hiyo, kulingana na jamaa huyu ambaye tumebana jina lake kwa sababu za kiusalama, kulitokana na yeye kudukuzi tarakilishi kwa lugha ya kimombo hacking na kugundua yaliyokuwa ya kijiri. Punde tu baada ya kujulikana, tambo mzima ulizimwa.
I got in through, let me just show you how I act. Got in through, found the database open, planted my things, captured their passwords without them noticing. That's the password that I used now into getting in. If I could have found they had logged out from the Oracle 11G, I couldn't have got in. They tried shutting down, and they were altering the reset logs so that when anything was set, it cannot like open, and that was unable to open. What this person did, he was restoring a database from a different computer to this particular server. And this was happening the same time that there was a turning off of the views at the Bomas. People were not able to view anything at the Bomas.
There were even videos done by blogs that showed that our technical logs of the servers and the technical logs of the IBC servers were the same, and therefore showed a cross read of data. John, let me just take it up to you again. The Supreme Court used soft data, so most times people are told to go into a common room and type their things, and then they send to themselves. Then in that case, then everyone, even called Jubilee, knew the result of the judgment long before it was read, because in the same argument they were using the same server and it was possible to cross-read. But the question is, here is, if the programmer of the server were of two different institutions handling two different issues and being done by a third party in the name of KenCon, then it was, by the way, for us, we also added our own server capabilities inside there. So beyond the servers that were being given by, we were being given by outsourcing, why we went is because we wanted a higher capacity, but we had our own smaller capacity to back up in case of anything, because we were very serious about data not getting lost. So even if we trusted the person we outsourced, we also had our own backup system. Our cabling for the backup was one, and those servers are still there, you know, let me tell you, data does not disappear. Even when you delete data, do you think it just disappears from the world?
To your mind, why would a call center need a fiber optic cable running to Bomas?
They won't need it at all. This was only for the connection of what they had planned. They had planned this one from the word go. Because not even a single day would a call center need fiber optic cable. What for? This was for the communication of what they thought was very secure. They thought their data was very secure. They didn't know that they had already left a port open. And this is the port that I took the advantage of and got in through. When these guys discovered that there was something going on in the background, this portal was shut down immediately and no one else could get it. Now, you saw when I showed you here, there was IEBC and there was MarketTrace. MarketTrace will give you this TNA portal. And IEBC will give you the same one, but under IEBC now. Schema, when you talk in a layman term, is like the owner of a database. It's called a schema. So there was a common schema, a common owner, which was KenCall, and because this was KenCall, KenCall had different branches called tables. The table for IEBC and the table for TNA. That one means that they were sharing the same owner. This owner could do anything. If you're an owner, you can manage and manipulate anything within your house. Schema is like the father, and when the tables are, those are the children, those are the children under one roof being managed by one person.
Tuliweza kufaulu na kuzungumza na jamaa mmoja aliye na taaluma ya database administrator na mojawapo ya benki ya Kenya inayotumia Oracle 11G kuhifadhi data zake kando na kudinda kupigwa picha. Alikiri kuwa server logs hizo haziwezi undwa na mtu mwingine ila kampuni ya Oracle. Fauka na hayo, alisema kuwa itakuwa vigumu kuamini na kupata ushahidi wa wadukuzi bila ya kupatikana kwa kompyuta iliyotumiwa wakati wa zoezi hilo kufanyiwa uchunguzi. Jambo ambalo liliungwa mkono na mfanyikazi mwingine anayefanya kazi na kampuni moja nchini Uingereza na ambaye pia alidinda kupigwa picha. Kando na hayo, tuliweza wasiliana na kampuni ya Oracle mara mbili kwa njia ya barua pepe, tukiwataka watupe nafasi ya kufanya mahojiano na afisa wao wa kitengo chao cha data kuhusiana na tuhuma hizo. Lakini hata baada ya kujaribu mara mbili, kampuni ya Oracle ilidinda. Ili tulazimu kuzungumza na wanadata wa humu nchini kutoka kampuni ya East Africa Data Handlers kupitia mkurugenzi wake George Njoroge, ambaye baada ya kupitia stakabadhi tulizokuwa nazo alitoa maoni yake.
The generation of the log files can be generated by a human being. They can be done by somebody, an individual. And if they do relate to IEBC, I would bet you money they were done by an individual, okay? And they are not legit. And these I would bet on anything that I have. The first thing that discredits this is the first element. When you look at the group, the log file, group one, the size of the log file is stated as 551,200 KB. That's the size of the log file. In comparison, if you were to think of it, the IEBC database for an election with about 30,000 polling stations, it cannot be less than 600, 700 GB. The log file would be close in about half of that, so about 200, 300 GB. So by somebody saying these log files are legitimately from the IEBC database, it is not true.
Tulimuonesha pia video ya jamaa aliyedaiwa kudukuza mtandao wa IEBC.
I queried a command on the TNA as a system database administrator, SysDBA, and we selected all from scott.market_res_crm, and we are able to find the live presidential results. And these tables, one could easily change them. The person who was setting up this database, when he used scott.market_res_crm, this was a fast way of doing things, because Scott is a default database. When you go under Scott, you'll find different columns of constituency code, constituency name, and these ones, if you click on them, it will open for you this other side of the tables, where when you change even a single figure here, whatever you change will be reflected on Scott results. Yes, this was the IEBC database, this other side.
This is not from an Oracle database, but it's from an SQL database. So this, you can see from here, the data is SQL, it is not Oracle. When that discredits the actual data sitting on an Oracle database then being produced on an SQL, it's not possible.
Hadi kufikia wa leo, licha ya juhudi zetu za kuwasiliana na afisa mkuu wa Kencol Nick Nesbitt kutaka majibu mahususi kuhusiana na tuhuma hizo za kampuni yake kuhusika katika tetesi za uchaguzi, Nick alitutaka tumtumie maswali tuliyotaka kuuliza ili aweze kutoa maamuzi ya kujibu au la. Mwenzangu John Alan Namu alijibiwa kwa ujumbe mfupi na kujulishwa kuwa swala hilo halimo tena. Kwa lugha ya kimombo, that chapter is closed. Chama cha CORD kilianza kuhisi kuwepo kwa udanganyifu, na hapa ndipo Kalonzo Musyoka alijitoa waziwazi na kukashifu vikali shughuli hiyo. Mkoko ulialika maua kiasi cha wana CORD kudai kulengwa tangu na mwanzo wa shughuli hiyo katika ukumbi wa Bomas.
The reality is that our members were thrown out. That's a fact. When in fact a committee had been set up to scrutinize, right? Even in the absence of that, you know, that whole thing about collapse of the electronic transmission, members insisted that they will then scrutinize these things themselves. Go to a stage where they were thrown out also, and IBC took charge.
Agents were not thrown out of the Tallinn Center. They were relocated to another office. We gave them a boardroom. The plan was this, Alan. The plan was that they will sit here and they will watch our officers do the tallying. And then they will be given a copy each of the results before the staff bring it to there. Remember, the commissioners were in a lounge, if you know the layout of Bomas. We were in a lounge behind the auditorium, while the secretariat was in the main tallying center. And they were into groups, 10 groups. So they were each scrutinizing the results and doing their correcting before they bring to the commissioners. So before they bring it to the commissioners, my instruction was that we give it to them and they keep it for half an hour. They go through it. If there's any objection, the chief agent was to bring it to my attention. So what they did is that they said, no, we must also countersign the forms. They created a space for themselves, not drawn to law, where they are now signing as agents, as chief agents, saying, okay, now we approve the result. They basically were saying, we cannot announce anything until we approve the results ourselves. And that's not the way it works. The commission does the job, you take the results. If you are unhappy, there's a procedure for challenging the results. You first raise with the returning officer. If you are unhappy with it, you go to a petition. So for a whole day, we could only announce 4 results. A whole day, 12 hours, only 4 results were announced. The other problem is that, apart from the chief agents, members of parliament and senators and governors who are elected, or some who lost the elections, came from all over the country to Bomas and started wearing observer badges. And they packed the tally center. And the staff were overwhelmed. We found staff completely paralyzed and not able to move or work. So as a commission, we sat and we sought for legal opinion. We asked our lawyers to research the law and tell us what we can do. And they were very clear in their opinion.
Kutokana na hofu ya ghasia za baada ya uchaguzi ya mwaka 2007, vyombo vya habari vilifeli na kuogopa kuelezea matatizo yaliyokuwa yakijiri wakati wa upigaji kura, pamoja na mauaji yaliyokuwa yakitokea sehemu kadhaa nchini. Ngoma ya usalama wa taifa ilipigwa, na hivyo basi kuwafanya wanahabari kujiangalilia tu na kufyata domo. IEBC ilifaulu kupenya bila ya kukashifiwa na wanahabari.
My running mate addressed a press conference and said that there was a manipulation of the result which was going on. Because at that time the media was being suppressed. So even the content of that press conference was never publicized.
The media has a vitally important role to play. It is the eyes and ears of the people. It must report honestly and frankly what it sees and what it sees to be wrong. Certainly, you can never hope for anything else. You can only hope for that. The media should find its own balance. The marketplace of information should ensure that the voting public know what's happening.
Matokeo yalianza kupokelewa katika jumba la Bomas, huku Uhuru Kenyatta akiongoza na Raila Odinga akimfuata kwa karibu. Hitilafu ya kura zilizokataliwa zilianza kusikika, huku kukiwa na madai ya kura hizo kuongezwa kwa pamoja mara 8 wekwa ndani ya data kama upigaji kura halali.
It's very difficult to know what happened with those rejected votes. We were initially told that the system mistakenly multiplied the number by 8, and that's why you saw so many rejected votes. That doesn't seem to pan out. When we ran the numbers ourselves, it didn't seem like multiplying by 8 would give us the numbers that we were getting. And it also seems a little bit odd that in an election as complex as this one, that you would have such a low number of rejected votes at the end of the day. We would expect more.
We asked our experts, and they analyzed it and came out with the answer to it, is that there were areas where there had been stuffing of votes, particularly presidential votes, where people got more ballot papers. And so the number of ballot papers, ballot cast in some of those stations were in excess of the number of voters who were registered. And the way the electronic system works is that if the numbers exceed 100%, and whatever is above the 100% is rejected. And that is what was showing in the screen as rejected votes. And that number was increasing almost exponentially. as the votes were being tallied. So it had reached over 400,000 rejected votes. Those were votes which had been cast over and above 100% of registered voters, those constituencies.
I can see people falling back on the most primitive system, which the Black Book was, because the fancy superstructure that you had created proved defective. So you've got to go back. It's undesirable. It evidences a breakdown in your administration, in your planning, in your execution. And you must learn a lesson from it and not repeat it next time.
The problem with the Green Book, well, there were several problems with the Green Book. One is that the public didn't know about it until the court case. Everybody had been told that it would be an electronic register compiled through the BVR kits, etc., and that your name and your information would be stored on a server, and that's the principal legal verifiable register. So when the Green Book came up, it was sort of like, where did this come from? Nobody knew about it.
Muda ulikuwa ukiyoyoma huku IEBC ikijipata kubanwa na wanasiasa kutoka vyama vyote husika. IEBC ilimalizia kufanya ukaguzi wake wa matokeo huku katika kambi ya Jubilee, Uhuru Muigai Kenyatta akitakiwa na wanakampeni wake wa tayari kuingia ikulu ya Nairobi, kwani walikuwa na uhakika wa kutoa uongozi.
We won this election at 6 a.m. By 9 a.m., the only thing I was doing myself is just checking the Assumption of Office Act and ensuring that we are able to second the right people, to the Assumption of Office team that was headed then by the head of civil service. We won this election at 9 a.m. 9 a.m., it was done and dusted. I told him my suit is ready.
And what did he say to you?
Okay. Let's pray God. Let's pray God.
IEBC iliishia kwa kumtangaza rasmi Uhuru Muigai Kenyatta kama rais wa nne wa Jamhuri ya Kenya.
Raila Odinga, 5,340,546. Uhuru Kenyatta, 6,173,433. Since Uhuru Kenyatta has received 6,173,433, he has received more than 50.07%. He has also received more than 25% in at least 32 counties. I therefore declare Uhuru Kenyatta the duly elected President of the Republic of Kenya.
Raila Odinga alijitokeza waziwazi na kupinga matokeo hayo, huku akiwasilisha lalama zake katika mahakama ya juu zaidi nchini.
Democracy is on trial.
Usikose kujiunga nami hapo kesho katika sehemu ya pili na ya mwisho ya dugudwa la uchaguzi. Muhammad Ali, makala ya Jicho Pevu, KTN.